Hello, my name is Joel Z. Williams, and welcome to Prop Skill Aircraft Model Building. Did you think you were going to get out of this without having a history lesson? Really? Thank you, and welcome to Tutorial 9. What I'm going to talk about here is the changing nature of the Japanese aircraft in July of 1943. Let's back up to Pearl Harbor. We know that the Japanese did a preemptive strike against the U.S. Pacific Fleet in December 7th, 1941. What they were able to do is essentially eviscerate the American capability to have projected naval power. Subsequently, we defeated the Japanese using aircraft power on our aircraft carriers, the Yorktown, the Lexington, I think the Midway, Enterprise. These were aircraft carriers that this was the first time the Japanese had ever really seen this type of warfare, that you're launching aircraft off of the top of flat deck, large naval vessels about the size of a battle cruiser or bigger, and that the aircraft are able to travel and fight with other carriers and other aircraft beyond the horizon. And so the USS, the Battle of the Coral Sea that we saw, where the Lexington was struck and actually sank, but it was the first time that American and Japanese navies had really engaged each other without actually having ever seen the capital ships of the opposing party. So the concept is that warfare is moving away from using battleships, where you would have big guns on slow moving ships, you know, using maneuver to try to get around each other and using the wind and the sun to try to. Now warfare has changed to putting bombs on the bottom of aircraft and actually sending them out and seeking other targets to hit. So, that being said, July 1943, the Japanese have really won a tactical victory at the Coral Sea, the Battle of the Coral Sea around the Philippine Islands. Japanese presence in the South Pacific is growing, and especially in the Caroline Islands. Nowadays, we call it Micronesia. But if you can imagine, they had a base there called Truk, which was a major center. I mean, they could overhaul aircraft and repair naval vessels. So it was a critical link to the Japanese Imperial Navy. And it was only about 2,000 or 3,000 miles away from what we would nowadays call Papua New Guinea. At the time, it was called New Britain. Guadalcanal comes to mind. New Ireland. These were islands where the Japanese figured out, okay, so the Americans are going to go with this new style of warfare. They're going to go away from their battleships because they don't have any more. We sunk them all at Pearl Harbor. They're going to depend on their aircraft carriers to put torpedoes and bombs on aircraft and launch them out to sea and hopefully spot one of our vessels and then try to sink it. And the Japanese said, that's pretty crafty. And you know what? We have some aircraft that could probably offset that tactic. And what they did is they came up with the Japanese Zero. And the Japanese Zero, I'm going to show you a photo of it. The Japanese Zero is essentially about the weight of a modern day SUV, about 5,000 pounds. So you're dealing with an aircraft that is maybe a third of the weight of the average American-born carrier fighter, which would have been probably either the SBD Dauntless, the Douglas model. SBD Dauntless. Or the Curtiss P-40, the Warhawk. So that's what the Japanese Zero would have been going up against, most likely. And Americans knew This fighter is much lighter, much more nimble, much more maneuverable. We can't get into dogfights with them. If we're ever going to compete with them, what we're going to have to do is get up high and kind of wait till they come underneath us and try to get them four ships at a time, four aircraft at a time, and try to just rain down bullets on them and try to get them like that. We're going to try to use our speed to dive to overcome the niftiness and the nimbleness of the Zero. Okay, so the Japanese, after Coral Sea, after that decisive battle where the Japanese were actually, it was a strategic American victory. We were able to keep them from landing, keep their naval ships from landing, but it was actually a tactical loss because the aircraft that were on the aircraft carriers that surrounded it, you had the Akagi, which means Red Castle in Japanese. It's a one of their best aircraft carriers ever. The Kaga, the Hiru, the Suru. You had these aircraft carriers that the Japanese aircraft carriers were essentially very basic. Just a flat top. Just, you know, somewhere to land the aircraft and launch them from. And the Japanese got to thinking and they said, you know, we did so much damage back in Coral Sea. Technically, it was a loss, but our aircraft had these high kill rates that where they were downing the Dauntless and the Hellfire and other American carrier-borne aircraft, downing them, no problem. Ratios, obscene ratios, like 12 to 1 for a Suguro Sakai, the one of the, I guess, aces of the Japanese First Naval Air Command. But they were experiencing these tremendous victories. And so the order came down in July 1943 as the Japanese realized we don't need to conquer every island. All we need to do is conquer every other island. And we can kind of when kids play hopscotch. We can hopscotch our way across the Pacific from the Caroline Islands to Truk Islands, and we can get closer to Australia. And at that time, Australia was one of our biggest allies. They gave us a lot of grain. When American farmers moved off the fields and went to work at these industrial plants or went off to war, the farming wasn't getting done. And so we were at a shortage of wheat and rice and all these staples. And Australia was growing them in bonuses, in surpluses. And so they were able to ship those to America in exchange for American arms and protection in the South Pacific. And what the Japanese realized in 1943 is, hey, if we take our carrier-borne aircraft and we take them off of the aircraft carrier dedicated to the Kaga, the Akagi, the Shiru, and the Hiru, we take them off of those carriers and we just build a very simple basic landing strip in the jungles around Australia, in New Britain, in Guadalcanal, in Rabaul. And we issue every Japanese service member a machete, and we basically say, go out in the jungle and clear an airstrip 1,000 meters long. And that's what they did. And so, if you can imagine, the Japanese in July of 1943 realized their weakness, and their weakness was that they only had four dedicated aircraft carriers, and only probably two of those were world class, the Akagi and the Kaga. The other two, the Hiru and the Suru, were kind of not really. They were third world kind of aircraft carriers, not really quite up to speed. And so they said, you know what? Let's just fly or sail some bunch of oil drums full of gasoline and oil, and we'll leave a platoon of maybe 40 guys out there and maybe 20 aircraft, and those aircraft can operate off these landing strips that are cut into the jungle that are reinforced with possibly coral, maybe seashells, any kind of rocks that they can gather. These aircraft are light. These Japanese Zeros are, relatively speaking, for a fighter aircraft are only 5,000 pounds. It's really, really light. You don't need a long runway. You don't need a lot of a crew to service them. Two or three people can push them around and move them around. Very maneuverable aircraft. So what we are left with is the 1943 Japanese Imperial High Naval Command directive that says, listen, we don't, and it says three things. We don't care what kind of aircraft you're flying, but if you're a Japanese aircraft and you're in the South Pacific, from now on, you're going to have to put yellow identification strips on the tips of your wings. We've had too much blue-on-blue action, too many friendlies shooting at other friendlies because it looks just like other American aircraft. So that was the one directive. The second directive was that we don't give a damn about how hard it is where you are. You're supposed to survive off of a bag of rice, some water, and sharp tools. And that's basically what they said. This war may take 10, 15 years. You're there to stay. The third order was to paint green splotches on every aircraft. And the order came out that every Japanese fighter that was in the South Pacific as a result of the move, the transition is strategic change in this paradigm shift and strategic thinking that we're going to move the fighter aircraft off of the aircraft carriers and make them land-based and operate to sever the shipping, control the shipping lanes between America and Australia, which the Japanese were experiencing tremendous effect and being very successful in that. The third directive said that you had to put jungle green splotches on every aircraft that was operating in the South Pacific. And for that reason, we're left with this color scheme. Good. I'm glad that the camera can pick that up. So this is the Mitsubishi Japanese A6M30. Didn't quite turn out like I would like it. The canopy's a little bit cloudy, more cloudy than I would have preferred. But otherwise, it has all the attributes of the July 1903 directive. It's, of course, got the yellow identification lines on the leading edge of the wing. It has the jungle splotches. And this particular aircraft was from Rabaul, so we're talking about Papua New Guinea, probably about August 1943. And you can see here, this is the antenna, the VHF antenna. Inside the cockpit is the UHF antenna, the ultra high frequency versus very high frequency. I just want you to get a good look at that. Not happy with that cockpit. I wish it hadn't been so cloudy. But I learned the lesson, and I learned my lesson from it, is that when you're building scale model aircraft, you're going to learn critical lessons. And the lessons I learned on this one is that you're going to need a sharp blade every time on your X-Acto knife. When you go to cut your tape, make sure you cut your tape with a very sharp X-Acto knife, and you make a very good tight seal on anything that you're trying to paint. I should have known that. Did not pay as close attention as I would have liked, and as a result, the end result is that there's a lot of cloudiness, a lot of overspray paint that I could technically get off, but I think I would damage it. I would do more harm than good. So, not 100% the way I would want it, but the lesson here is that it's still a very good model. There's still a very good accurate representation of aircraft that would have been likely found in that region of the world at that time. As you will learn as you work on aircraft model, as you experience this craft, there are going to be regrets. There's going to be things that you wish, man, I wish I could have done that differently. But one thing that will never happen again is I will never mask off a cockpit without properly making sure that the panes are well cut. The tape is cut with a fresh blade. So I guess what I'm trying to say is you learn from your mistakes, and don't be afraid to make mistakes. Mistakes show that you are growing, show that you are learning. Malcolm Gladwell, a sociologist from Canada, wrote a recent book, is called Outliers. One of the things that he said is the common denominator between anyone that's successful is that they spent 10,000 hours working on their particular craft. So whether you're Jimi Hendrix and you're playing a guitar, whether you're a model builder on YouTube who works on aircraft models, whether or not you're Yo-Yo Ma and you work and you play the cello, if you spend 10,000 hours doing anything, you're going to be very, very good. So you can anticipate, if you haven't got quite to the 100-hour mark, you can anticipate that you're going to encounter difficulties that are going to make your artwork not look perfect. And don't be afraid of that. Learn from your mistakes. Herald your mistakes like I do. Show them like a badge of courage. This canopy doesn't look good, but you know what? That camouflage is sick. That camouflage scheme is sick. See what I'm saying? So if you can take anything from this lesson, know that you're going to make mistakes. Learn from your mistakes. Learn with your successes. Thank you. This is Props Skill Aircraft Model Building. We're making history here.